Is it your loyalty to Richie that's making you all think it wasn't a red? Because most neutrals are saying it was a red. And, you know, it's pretty much only ex-Kilkenny players who would have played with Richie that's saying it's not. Do you know what I mean? Are you in danger? Like, I understand why you would think that. Richie's not that type of player. You know him personally.
No, that shouldn't come into it. In fact, you know, that sort of player doesn't.
Why is it only ex-Kilkenny players that are actually think it wasn't a red when most other people think it was?
Yeah, so look, it's a game of opinions, really, more than that. And, if we're playing club championship a couple of weeks' time, and if that tackle goes in, I don't think it's going to be a red card.
The GAA Hour with Colin Parkinson is brought to you by Paddy Power, home of the Money Back Special.
So the Independent are reporting that the Kilkenny County Board are going to appeal Richie Hogan's red card. JJ, this is never going to end.
Yeah, I suppose, look, it's just really regarding he won't have a suspension next year more than anything. I don't think it's got to do with, rightly or wrongly, he was sent off or not. I say it's just appealing that so he would be available for the Leinster Championship. We've seen how valuable it was to have every player available for Leinster Championship because it went down to a puck of ball if you're going to get it or not. So I'd say they're probably looking ahead rather than looking back.
Right.
That they need their full outfit now for Leinster Championship next year because he will, if he gets the red card, obviously he'll get rid of the card. It will be a suspension and that'll carry on to the Championship next year.
So it'll be the first round of the Leinster Championship.
Yeah, you presume it would be, yeah. So they're probably looking ahead rather than looking back. I don't think he's acting about if it was the right or wrong decision on Sunday. I don't think that's entered their head at all.
Well, it must enter their head or else if they didn't think it was the wrong decision, they wouldn't appeal.
Yeah, but it's not a case of, it's a case of looking forward to a next year's Championship. Not. Yeah. To, for right or wrong, that will happen there on Sunday, I'd say, you know.
Because when I was at the match, it was RTE that was on in Croke Park when I went in to have a look at it. So I saw what Henry had to say, heard what Jackie's had to say. Brian Hogan's been on Twitter. You know, the Kilkenny high-profile pundits, and there's a lot of them, have all been singing off the same hymn sheet. Where are you on it? I didn't hear what you were saying on Sky.
Yeah, no, I said the exact same thing at halftime, to be honest with you. My initial reaction, you probably have to go back to your initial reaction when you've seen the actual incident when it happened straight away. I didn't think it was, to be honest, a straight red. I suppose, looking...
I have to say, neither did I.
You're pointing to the replay, but when the replay is a slowdown and everything like that as well. When you go shoulder someone, your arm is not straight down by your body. It's up there, and that was his hand he was holding a hurl bit. So it's up there now. He probably went up 45, he didn't go up 90 degrees on it, but again, this has been covered to death now over the last while. I suppose the important thing to say is, probably did it impact Tipperary winning the game? I thought 15 or 15, the way they played in the second half, I thought they would have got over line anyway. It would have been a bit closer, all right. So, probably people are saying that it wasn't a red card, and that's I thought it was a yellow at best. But I will go on to say that if tipped the way they played in the second half, the way they used the ball, the way they went, the man on man, 50-50 ball when it came down, Barry Heffernan was catching ball over Walter. Roland Maher was winning the battle against Colin Finley as well. The way they hurled in the second half, 15 or 15, I thought Tip would win anyway, to be honest with you, the way they played in the second half. Now, that's saying now, I think the narrative is some lads are trying to spin it that a few Kilkenny lads are saying that it wasn't a red card, so like that's why Tip won. I don't think that's why Tip won.
Is it your loyalty to Richie that's making you all think it wasn't a red? Because most neutrals are saying it was a red, and you know, it's pretty much only ex Kilkenny players who would have played with Richie that's saying it's not. Do you know what I mean? Are you in danger? Like, I understand why you would think that. Richie's not that type of player. You know him personally.
No, that shouldn't come into it. In fact, you know, that sort of player doesn't.
Why is it only ex Kilkenny players that are actually think it wasn't a red when most other people think it was?
Yeah, so look, it's a game of opinions, really. More than that, and if we're playing club championship a couple of weeks' time, and if that tackle goes in, I don't think it's going to be a red card. That's where the issue is, you know.
Yeah.
And I know there's the inconsistency is brought up again, and I've seen the clip going around the place on Bill Cooper as well. It's different times, different games.
It was a different type of one though. His elbow wasn't up.
But again, if you go to the letter of law, it was the same tackle, you know. The kind of, but it's different time, different game. I don't think that shouldn't be a reason why he should be sent off. My issue would be is that in 2 weeks' time we're playing championship in the club. If that same tackle goes in, it wouldn't be a red card. So, and if I received it, I wouldn't be expecting a red card. Because my issue, actually, Damien Lawrence said to me on the sideline, I said to him, look, James Owens has talked to him, he'll be okay, it's a yellow card, and that's it. When he's seen the red, usually when a red card is very, very obvious, the player's reaction tells it all. And Richie's reaction was he was actually in shock when he seen the red card himself. So I've been sent off before, and I've seen the red, and I was expecting the red to come out, and I put the head down and walk off straight away. I wasn't shocked to get it, you know.
Yeah, no, there's no doubt it was shocked. Paddy Stapleton here is here as well. Paddy, what do you think?
Sure, look, I'd hate to go again, you know, but I obviously do think it was a sending off, like most you learn from Kilkenny, like, and that's no slight again. You're admirable to support Richie, but I suppose the other thing, if that shoulder had been even in the chest, I still think it would have been a sending off. I've been in that position. I actually, unfortunately, got sent off a few years ago in a club game challenging Jamie Callanan. And again, I don't think it was meant by Richie. It wasn't meant by me. But when you're trying to read the situation, he was trying to read him going down the line. He got stepped, but your momentum brought him straight in and lifting the arm. If he hadn't lifted the arm, maybe not. Now, he didn't mean to hit him in the head, but he did hit him in the head. And by letter of law, that's off the field. And the fact it's kind of reckless. If that was only two of them standing up and jostling each other and one was moving to the left and an elbow was raised, I don't think it is. But it looks excessive, you know, caused a bit of an injury on the ground. So, look, I think it was a red card. Hate to see him going off because I don't think he's one bit of a dirty player. He's a great player and a great ambassador. But yeah. Unfortunately, like, it's terror that has to happen on that day. But, like, you know, is it more acceptable that it's a red if Cathal Barrick gets knocked out? You know, then are we saying, oh, it's a red card, so it's either dangerous or it's not? And look, I thought it was just, he didn't mean for it, and it's an All-Ireland final. And but even in a league match, that can happen. You're going as hard as you can. You think you can nail a lad with a legitimate shoulder. And when you take that chance, and you're all taking a chance, and it doesn't come off, then the result is bad.
That's the thing. It's like most mistimed challenges, which is what it was. And he was a little bit thick at the time. And like you see it in soccer, a player nudges the ball ahead just a split second before a tackle, and you mistime it, and you didn't mean to do it. You were going for the ball, but you did mistime it, and you caught him. Like, I mean, the rule is, and this was fresh guidelines and instructions that were sent out this year, and it says, if contact is made to an opponent's head, if opponent has no opportunity to protect himself, if contact impact is excessive or causes injury, if the elbow forearm hurley is part of the contact. Do you know what I mean? That's a red card, and it's ticking those boxes. Yeah. So technically it was, JJ, and I do take your point. I'm not sure about Richie going on off the ball the other day. Like, I mean,
come here, I suppose he's entitled if he wanted to get his own point of view.
Yeah, no.
A bit soon, but maybe he wanted to get out there and put it to bed and then forget about it as quickly as possible, really, more than that. Maybe that's what was in his head. I suppose he wanted to get his own side out. And look, I thought he spoke very well, but
it keeps it in the news, you know.
Yeah,
like, I mean,
maybe now it'll be put to bed. Maybe if it'll be put to bed this week.
Well, now Kilkenny are appealing it, so it's not being put to bed.
Yeah,
like,
but
are Kilkenny dealing with this well?
But if he came out next week and done that interview, that'll bring it up again. You know what I mean? I'm saying for this week, this end of this week, forget about it. He go back to his club. He's playing Cup Championship now Saturday or Sunday week, so he'll have to focus on that then again. Like, you know what I mean? Maybe get it out of the way now. Forget about it. Come the weekend, something else is going to happen. Something else is going to be in the limelight, and then it's going to be put to bed, really, more than I can say. For his own sake, I'd say it's just, he'd probably think, right, come out here now, do this interview.
Yeah.
Put my say it out. Forget about it after, I think.
I'd say I wouldn't like to be the person that rang him up. There's no way I'd ring a fella on a Tuesday that has been sent off in an All-Ireland final. Not in a million years. But look, I can see where he's coming from. But the point I'm making, JJ, and I don't necessarily need you to be trying to criticise your own county, but between the Richie Hogan interview, between the pundits all going on about it, and now between appealing it, that this red card, which most neutrals think it was a red card, has like dominated the news cycle of the All Ireland. When
there are three individual situations. It's not a case of everyone got together and said this is what we're going to do, from county board to ex pundits or to pundits from ex players and Richie Hogan. There are three individual situations. It's obviously happened at one. It's a big talking about the moment. So whoever did make that phone call probably wasn't expecting Richie to answer it, but he answered and he took the interview, and it looks very easy for him to just hide away from it. But he manned up and done the interview, in fairness. Yeah. Like, you know, so probably the county board thing, that's probably out of Richie's hands if they were up to themselves to appeal that. And again, ex pundits or the pundits now at the moment, everyone's asking the question now at the moment. Do you know what kind of way it's...
Well, on Twitter, they're not being asked. And
yeah, well, sure. Well, that's...
If they're sticking it out there.
Yeah, there's a few guys are doing it, like, you know, and you're kind of saying that it's getting a bit embarrassing seeing your one on Twitter there yesterday, all right, but then that's the first question you're asking me there again today. That's going to bring it out again, you know, that kind of way.
Yeah.
So
I'm not accusing you of that. Your Twitter has been very quiet. I went to check it out.
Yeah,
now, I hope JJ isn't crying about this on Twitter. But you weren't. But this is the thing, and just to finish up on this, Paddy, and something I don't really like, and I should have pulled Cheddar up on it here on Monday, but Jackie started this off on Sunday night and Sunday game, blaming Cathal Barrick for not getting up fast enough. And JJ, or Cheddar, had it as well, and I'm annoyed with myself for not pulling him up on it. But like, I've looked at the replay of that, lads, and you can see heavyweight boxers get that glancing blow on the chin, and your legs go. And the way Cathal Barrick fell back in an unnatural position on one of his legs, like, it looked like he was completely disorientated when he fell, Paddy. I don't think it's fair to stick it out there. Like a glancing blow for a heavyweight boxer, suddenly you're wondering, how did he go down from that? But you know what I mean? But you do.
I would be hoping that they're just trying to make excuses for why it wasn't a red card, because I think it was very irresponsible to be saying that about a head injury. And for the last 2 years, what we talked about, we're talking about concussions. We're looking at in other sports, American football and the likes, and we're trying to stop the heavy hits on the head. So we're saying that, you know, that fella isn't injured, who clearly got a fairly heavy strike onto the head. It was very disappointing to see that, especially from a fellow player who we've all got slapped. So who is anybody else to decide how sore or how much of a knockout it was getting on the ground? Like I've received shots in the head before and been concussed two or three times, and you don't know where you are. And even if you just get startled, you might need to stay down for a minute to see how you are. So I think that was very, very poor. And you know, in fairness, we're talking like Richie was travelling fast. It wasn't like he hit him and he was right there beside him afterwards. He flew by him. So I mean, that tells you enough that he's travelling at a pace, and it's enough to cause a bit of damage. So like, what I'm thinking is, if he's knocked out, is that saying that it was, you know, is that better that it was less of a dangerous tackle? I just think it was in poor taste enough putting it on Cathal Barrett's door that Richie Hogan was sent off, and I think that's what it was really doing.
Yeah, I would agree with that, JJ. Like, I mean, I don't know what you think of it. I remember I was knocked out in an under-21 game before, and if you were to look at the video of it, it didn't look like, you know what I mean? Mm. It didn't look like much, but if your head is knocked across.
Well, I've experienced this in honour, find myself. Cyril Donnan got sent off for hitting me as well, but I was on the ground and got back up again. But the reason, it wasn't a case of Anton staying down or getting up to confront Cyril, but a couple of years before that, Tommy got up straight away, and that was just
with Benny Dunn.
Yeah, that's the first thing that popped into my head, like, just get up and kind of reason why Tommy got up there. That's the mentality, that's the first thing that popped into my head. Get up off the ground now and don't show any.
But here's the thing about this, is that Barrett was right beside the backroom team and the medical crew rushed on straight away.
And which,
you know,
which,
so that's not Cathal's right fault, and they have to go through the...
Yeah, no, that's 100%. You know, that's no issue regarding the medical team coming on with any belt in the head.
Well,
sorry?
The difference in Tommy's, and Tommy's was a strike into the face.
No, I'm not saying that. No,
a heavy blow that can rattle your head.
Like, I'm only saying
Tommy
the reason.
Even said before, he'd only go up because he got taken off before for a blood substitution and never let back on. So I think it just has to be, you know, what's right is right there, and that, you know.
No, I'm only saying that the reason why I got up was that Tommy got up there a couple of years before that. That was that's triggered my head. That's why I just hop up straight away on it. That's the only reason. I didn't say anything about the belt or anything like that. And it was probably not got to do with Benny Dunn or Cyril Dunn and that Tommy or the reason that I got up either. Like, you know, it's just in case of, right, get up now because he done it a couple of years before. Do you know what
I just think, well, Cathal Barrett's obviously responded back to Jackie. He says, Jesus, Jackie, that's a bit harsh. I'm surprised at him. I was a little dazed. It wasn't my decision. The doctor has to assess me. There's nothing I can do. The more I try to get up, I can't. I was a bit rattled, so the doctor did assess me. He wasn't going to let me back until he answered the protocol questions. He asked a couple of questions and checks your eyes and things like that. And, are you okay or whatever? I think, Jackie, on the Sunday game, I think that's harsh now, because nobody knows what... How rattled Cathal.
Only Cathal knows and the doctor knows.
And the blow did rattle his head across. It's not like he did. There was no contact there. There was. So, like, I don't know. I think the Jackie and Cheddar trying to throw at the Cathal, I think, is a little bit harsh, because you just don't know.
No, you don't know. You know, he only knows, and the doctor knows what kind of circumstances were in it. Like, so,
yeah.
No, it's completely. He got up and got on and played a brilliant game in the second half now as well. Like, you know, so probably. Yeah, the red card in this instance probably taking up more airtime than what Tipperary done. Like, you know, because you have to give him credit as well. Like,
that's what I think. I think this red card has dominated too much of this week when it should be about the All Ireland champions. Yeah, you know, like, I mean, that's the kind of issue I had. Talking about Cathal Barrett's performance then in the second half, Paddy, I'll start with you, because he was the spare man, and at halftime I would have been thinking, Jesus, you don't put your best man marker as a spare man. That's silly. And then he appears as the spare man. And then, amazingly, I read these quotes. I had no instructions for the free roll. I was free. It was just instinct. You play it as you see it. The boys have given us enough coaching over the last 9 months. They trust us on the field. That's Cathal Barrett. And I can't comprehend that he's the best man marker. He's put as a spare man, and he's not even given an instruction about how to play the role.
Well, yeah, I think what happened down through the years, traditionally anyway, certainly when I played cornerback, A lot of the time, if a leg gets sent off, the other team will play with two inside forwards, and it will be maybe your best other person in the full back line to play as your spare man. I know sometimes you might get maybe a Paddy Maher that, but I thought this was the best one, because really, like, he was able to cover class. He's so fast. I think speed is a huge thing with the spare man, because you can cover all the angles very, very quickly. And, like, he's probably an underrated hurler, but maybe an underrated sticks man. Like, his touch and his passing is brilliant. So I was delighted to see him as spare man, because I think there was big men that the likes of Paddy Maher were to mark, and Ronan Maher was to mark. And I think on that day we needed Ronan Maher on Colin Fennelly, and we needed somebody on TJ Reid. So he was probably the best man for the job. And his massive confidence as well, like the likes of Barry Heffernan, you know, you're delighted if he's in there in his second or third match ever, just marking a man and dominating him. But Colin had the experience and definitely has the speed. Like, speed is huge. And as well, as a cornerback, you know that your job really to jump up and get involved in high balls between a fullback and a full forward. Whereas if you had a ball player, Brendan Maher, or you had a Paddy Maher, they could be getting confused in their role that maybe they're to come for the primary ball, but a cornerback knows they're to wait down for the breaks. And how many breaks did he pick up off men? So I think it was a very, very good decision by the management, and something I'd always look for as a cornerback as a spare man.
Right, okay. What do you think, Jay? Immediately I thought surely Paddy Maher would come out now and play the sweeper, which he's really good at. But I take Paddy's point. Paddy might have, the temptation might have been to actually jump with that. And he was man-marking Walter Walsh. So.
Yeah, and Paddy probably would have been trying to go up the field there as well, whereas Barry was sitting in front of the full back line there as well. But yeah, no, it was a valid point there as well. 10 minutes ago before half-time, I think Paddy was getting top of Walter Walsh there as well. Like, you know, caught a couple of balls. He caught the ball off him for Tip's first goal there as well, and can launch up that attack, you know. So yeah, I was expecting kind of Paddy to go back there on it, but no, it was a great move. And Cottle Baird was very, very good with the ball and as well, like, you know, intelligent, go out one side and crossfield ball the other side there as well, like, you know. So but couple of the balls were hit in, were in on top of him there as well, and he didn't, all he do is wait for the ball to come to him, which is probably disappointing from any point of view, you know, the kind of way. But then launched an attack there as well. But after 10 minutes, Tip got to 2.5 to 3 points, I think. And after that, Kilkenny had to kind of push on and go for the goals, which had played into Tipperary's hands. When you know a team's coming at you, very easy to sit back, and then, but they're on the counter attack. But a couple of balls that the forwards got, I think Bubba's got one running over towards the line, and he was literally on the end, or the sideline, and hit it over the bar. You know what I mean? The Kilkenny defence done everything they could to stop him. He just had the ability to just hit the ball over the bar. That's what the Tipperary forwards had now.
Yeah, and it was funny, Brian Cody was interviewed afterwards, Paddy, and he thought the Kilkenny defenders were magnificent, and I wouldn't disagree with him. Like, some of the defending was really good. It's just when Tip forwards are on song there, there's no real stopping them, and they were getting an endless supply of good quality ball.
Yeah, supply, yeah. I think a couple of things happened. I think the ball in got a little bit faster and more direct in a way that was directly where it should be, but the runs on the inside were better. I think they were too static in the first half. By the time the ball was in, they were waiting for it, and when you're waiting for it, your man is on your back. So I think that was much improved. But let's be honest, like, the spare man helped that an awful lot. Look, there was primary possession one and all that, but around the middle, Kilkenny just didn't seem to have the legwork to get around and make it that dogfight. If you even think Adrian Mullen, you know, Richie Hogan's gone off, so he's one less forward. Adrian Mullen is supposed to have been sick, you know what I mean? He didn't look himself. So there's another set of legs that'll work hard. Colin Fennelly probably isn't the kind of the fitness level he was before. So if you're looking at putting that pure intensity on the Tipperary backs coming out, they just didn't look like they were able in the second half. And the more Tip drove at him from the back, as in ran hard at him, the more they brought Kilkenny out of position, and then you started opening in holes. But look, the likes of Hugh Lawler did brilliant. Joey Holden, in fairness to him, whatever he could do, he was doing. Probably the lack of dominance in the half-back line hurt him a lot. But, I've been in that position, I'm sure JJ has before, where the ball is just pinging and you're only trying to stay alive, that's all. You're only trying to balk him, maybe make a man take a pint or make him hit a wide, and it's a horrible position to be in.
Yeah, no, it definitely is. They were working it through the half-forward line much easier in the second half, JJ.
And Noel McGrath got a load of ball there as well.
Yeah, and
the
John.
One guy that you don't need on the ball is Noel McGrath. Yeah. He put in your pocket from 60 yards. He's phenomenal. And he's just a playmaker. He just rarely mishits the ball, and we spoke him in length all season, to be honest with you. But on the biggest day of them all, unfortunately for any point of view, he got on too much ball in the second half there as well. He just made the whole thing tick. The ball was just bouncing in front of the forward there as well. So it's what Paddy said, you're hoping now he'd take a shot at the ball.
Do you think Brown would be marking him, JJ, or what did you think?
No, I thought Killian would mark him, but I think a few lads were saying that kind of it's a lot for Conor Brown, his first All Ireland final, to go toe-to-toe with.
Yeah, he'd done well on the other
pace.
Lads though, didn't he?
He did, a bit more pace than Killian there as well, so that's why. And Killian and Noel probably be UCD, you know, they knew each other game very, very well, alright, but unfortunately, you know, second half, Killian ran out of legs and Noel just kind of dominated the whole thing. Now he's coming short. He was a kind of quarterback as well. He coming short, coming out midfield, coming to half back line. He was even taking near the end. He was taking puckers from Brian Hogan there as well, 30 or 40 yards of his own goal. But he was still finding the forward in the Tipperary. He took out so well. Anytime he got the ball in the hand, he took out probably six or seven Kilkenny players with a ball in. So it's very, very hard to defend when you have a guy with that ability that has that time on the ball as well.
Yeah, look, there's no doubt about it. Paddy, I don't know if you're at the homecoming, but I was reading some comments and Tipperary are going to start treading on dangerous ground. Again, Sheedy said, this is a very special night for us as a team. You, the fans, have been outstanding to us. All I will ask is that you stick with us because this is a team that means business. Come on, Tip. Then Shamie Callanan, captain, said, times like these don't come around too often. Back in 2010, everyone thought it would be year after year. We can't say it will definitely happen again next year, but we can promise you that we'll do our very best. Hold up now, Tipperary. Celebrate that, All Ireland. Do not make the same mistakes as 2016 and stop talking about next year.
The two in a row t-shirts are printed already, Paddy, are they?
Two in a row. Jesus Christ.
In fairness, that was important to say, that was at the homecoming, and in another interview Sheedy played it down and says 2020 is 2020 and that doesn't start for a few months yet, so I have to be fair to it, but I just saw those two quotes and I went, Jesus lads,
jump all over
a few jars or head. The Palace in Dublin is to blame for that.
Yeah, maybe it was. So come here, Hawkeye, anyways, we have to talk about Hawkeye because I don't know if you saw an angle, Justin McNulty tweeted it out, we tweeted it out from the show account here, and it's probably the most definitive angle of the attempt. And to me, it looked like a point, actually. And I don't know why there is no camera, actually, maybe even on the goalpost, even a GoPro. Yeah. Like, I mean, it's not that hard to do. But his hand did look behind. And Hawkeye have come out, JJ, and they have said this week we can confirm that the Hawkeye system installed at Croke Park can determine if the ball crosses the line. The system only gives a point when the ball has crossed the plane of the goals and in between the goalposts. The point in the this point in the trajectory of the flight is signified by the trajectory changing from red to white. Some people are wondering, you know, the white, or it goes confusion. Way over. It's a bit of confusion. To me, I was thinking after the game, it wasn't. Yeah. After seeing the angle closer, his hand bends back. I mean, I'm starting to trust Hawkeye then.
Yeah, I suppose that's a good point to clarify, because when you're seeing it on television, you're probably thinking, sure, they're probably just following the flight of the ball. If Brian doesn't get up his hand, it goes over the bar, which that's fair enough, right? But yeah, Brian was fairly adamant that, and I kind of backed the player with this now, he was fairly adamant that he caught the ball and said he didn't hit the crossbar at all, and he kind of came out with it. So I tried to go on the player's point of view. Once he said that, I'd probably go with the player, really, rather than Hawkeye now, to be honest.
That he saved it, yeah. What do you think, Paddy? Did you see that angle I'm talking about?
I did. I still don't think it's definitive when you can't see it. Like, I know from a Tipperary point of view, I obviously don't care. Like,
yeah,
you know, I'm just wondering.
It's not definitive, but it would definitely make you think it's more. It's like it would make you understand Hawkeye a bit more, or no?
Yeah. Well, I was looking at an explanation in the Examiner, and at least it's getting to the nitty gritty that there's an infrared line going across or whatever beam. But I just don't know, is that including his fist? Is that when the first breach of the crossbar comes? Like, is that right? Because if the ball hits the inside of a post and pops out, that's not a goal, or that's not a point. So how can it be a point if it's going over the crossbar? I don't know. I just think they need to clarify it and say, okay, if it touches this beam in the middle of the crossbar, then we consider it a point. And then you can say, fine, move on about the whole thing. But I think, because, look, if he's a tall goalie, it's definitely probably going to happen to him once or twice more in his career. And who knows who else, or whoever taps it down to Hurley. If the Hurley goes back and touches the infrared line and comes forward and touches the ball down, is that going to be a pint as well? So, look, I think they're just, it's only a small thing. But if it was, you know, if that was a pint in that match the other day, then look, we'd be kind of really, really analysing in a lot more depth. So they need to get it done, so they're not under pressure.
Is it a whole ball that has to go over the...
See, that's not fully clarified either. But how much of the ball...
A sideline or a goal, a whole ball has to go over
the... Oh, yeah.
Line.
Yeah.
So I'm presuming that's the same for.
You'd
for
imagine
hockey.
The whole ball should be over, yeah.
But you need to clarify that.
But how can you tell that then? With yeah. the fist in play and everything. I'm just a bit. It's a bit grey, I think.
Yeah, of course. Without a bloody camera on that angle, if they had that, you would know straight away. Yeah, like, I mean, why? I don't know why Croke Park don't have something like that. Installed, or even wouldn't it make sense for RT or Sky to have that? If Sky had it and RT didn't have it, and they could absolutely clarify this, wouldn't it be great for them? Everyone would be moving across to watch you, JJ.
You're obviously not doing it at the moment, will you?
Well, I flick over when I'm at home, but in Croke Park, obviously, they just have RT on it. Like, I mean, I will flick. I'd be interested to see what both panelists are saying about whatever thing. But yeah, come here. So news is Micheál Donoghue has stepped away from Galway. This is surprising news now because he signed a 2-year extension. JJ, I'll start with you. Mm. So obviously he won 2 Leinsters, a league and an All-Ireland. Like, yeah. I mean, he's had a brilliant innings. This is with Galway, who, let's be honest, were perennial losers, like, no disrespect, but they weren't winning All-Irelands before he got in there. He signed a 2-year extension, so it is a surprise. What's your take on this? They obviously did very disappointing this year, but it was they only lost out on scoring difference. It's not like they had a complete system collapse.
Yeah, he could have had a completely different last year of his campaign. So when you're looking back at it in a few years' time, now he'd be kicking himself that small thing. A few things went against him, Joe, obviously with injuries and all that kind of stuff. But look, I suppose come back to where Galway were before he took it over and where they are now are in 2 completely different places. So that in itself is a massive, massive boost for Micheál Donoghue's credentials as well. Like, you know, but they were getting so far, semi-finals, an odd final, semi-finals, an odd final, but they never could get over the line. But only with Micheál, you've seen a different kind of Galway, kind of steely kind of Galway as well. The couple of brilliant games with Tipperary and a couple of semi-finals as well, and they got over the line in one and kind of bet on the other one. But yeah, I think just looking back on it, he'll obviously at the moment, last couple of months, he's kind of looking back in regret over what happened this year. But if he stands back and looks after his whole career with Galway, he has to be very, very happy. He brought back Liam McCarthy to Galway the first time in years, like, you know, so that can never be took away from him either. But it was surprised he went now, to be honest, because nucleus of the team is there for, and then the hurt they had this year as well. You see Tipperary now this year, the hurt they had last year from finishing up the Munster Championship and not being in the All-Ireland series was huge. You can see that in the players as well. So he would have gotten another kick off the kind of older statesmen like Joe now and Dottie Burke and all these guys.
Yeah.
And he would have got an extra kick off them next year as well. So someone will be walking into a nice little job there, I'd say.
They will. It's almost like Liam Sheedy last year, Paddy, coming into Tipperary after a bad year. Galway, a lot of experienced players. Whoever takes that job, like, I mean, it's not a job that you want to go in and be ripping up any sort of scripts. It's just, and well, they've won 4 of the last 5 minor All-Irelands, but should they win them every year? that's par for the course. Do. That's par for the course with Galway. How many of them we'll see, we don't know.
No, and that's it. But as I say, the most important thing is they have a nucleus of leaders. They have a kind of a strong back line. They have a few talented forwards. But the only thing you'd worry about is, like, they obviously liked Micheál Donoghue. We've had him for a year, and he's a tough fella. Makes a lot of sense. Makes it very simple to hurling. But they liked him. They didn't really like Anthony Cunningham, so they never got over the line. So how much will they like the next fella? And you just be hoping that they're all very happy going into their pre-season next year, because if they're not, will that lead to them finding it difficult for the next few years? They shouldn't. There's some great players, great nucleus, good young lads coming on. But that is the only worry I'd have, because they have had a history of not getting on with management or having bad luck with them. And the minute they got somebody good, like Micheál Donoghue, that they really valued, then he's had to leave. And maybe, you know, you don't know, like inter-county management, I know talking to a couple of, you know, Darry Egan, and just talking about the commitments, and he just said it's frightening, the commitment that goes into it. So you couldn't blame any man for stepping away. And even though maybe last year he said, yeah, 2 more years would be lovely, maybe after this year it kind of became too much.
Yeah, I think it was family commitments were the main reason, JJ. What do you think of the successor then? Because Paddy makes a good point about the players. And Pat Kearney, who is the county board chairman, says the players won't have a direct say, but we will discuss it with them. Like, I mean, I suppose if they're discussing with them, they are kind of having a direct say.
They're okay or not.
But I think that's important too. And I think it's moved on from the county board just picking a lad and say, look, deal with him. Yeah. That's your manager. Shut your mouth. Yeah. That's just a recipe for disaster. So I don't, players should never decide the manager, but I think it would be stupid from any committee not to say, what do you think?
They have to bounce ideas off him. 100% have to. Look, we're going to talk to X, Y, and Z. What do you think of these three or four people now that are going for it? And yeah, hundreds, they have to, if the players don't go from it, it doesn't matter what manager you have, it doesn't make a difference, you know. So, and then they'll be probably talking to the core kind of elder statesmen of that group there as well, that will probably feel out a few of the younger lads as well, see what they think. But the majority of them, probably the lads 29, 30, will be have the, probably three or four of them, that's all they talk to, but that's all they need to talk to really more than, because if you get the main guys on board, the rest of them will fall into place anyway. But I think it'd be very naive for any county board not to talk to the core group of the leaders in the dressing room to see, right, we're talking X, Y, and Z. What do you reckon? We'll see what they come up with now in the garden. It's probably an interview now that the county board will have to do with the three or four guys and whichever impress them about that. But they surely have talking to their preferences really more than that, without giving them a voice really more than that. But because you can't let players not have a voice now at the moment as well, because it'll turn them back at you fairly quickly.
And you could lose 2 years with a manager they don't like, and then that's a disaster. Jeffrey Linsky is the front runner, apparently. He's the minor. He won the last three minor All-Irelands, I'm pretty sure, with them. And Brian Hanley, who won another minor All-Ireland, he's in the mix as well. Outsiders then is Anthony Daly, Derek McGrath, Davy Fitzgerald. Paddy, if he doesn't stay with Wexford, wouldn't be too far from Clare. They've had such success with the last Clare manager they had. I think Davy is more of an underdog type manager. They're all against this type of stuff rather than one of the big kind of more traditional counties, no?
I definitely think so. I wouldn't think Davy will be a big mix, and even system wise as well, I don't know how long, if the results aren't flowing straight away, how long his type of tactical play will go down well by supporters and players. Like, I don't know. Like, it's not slight. I'm actually, to be honest, I used to enjoy a lot of his hurling, and now I really have. I think he's done an unbelievable job at Wexford. As you say, I think he's more of an underdog story, that people listen to that shtick, where I don't know whether they listen to it with Galway. The interesting thing, Linsky is one of the top men, but I remember Declan Ryan and Tommy Dunn came into us in 2011 after being over the minors, and in my own opinion, it's a different world. It's completely different, and you're coming into players who are used to a certain way, a certain knowledge, certain analysis, and if you can't provide that, it doesn't matter how many minors you've won. Not matter. They're all grown-ups now. They're not kids in school. And to me, these players will have known of Linsky, they'll have known of his methods, and they'll fairly wipe the table before that happens if he's not up to scratch or not. I've no idea of the quote, but like, if it was me and I was from Galway, I'd be hoping for somebody like an Anthony Daly. I think the way he speaks about hurling, what I've heard about him from Dublin hurlers, tactically very good, able to get lads on his side, but a massive fire. If that was me in that dressing room, that's who I'd be looking for.
Yeah, no, I do take your point about the minor managers. It'd be like any of us going into an inter-county setup. How do you know what's required, unless you get someone who potentially has been with a team before with you?
Made a big background team with you, you know what I mean? With a bit of experience there as well. So, yeah, it's vitally important, but it's important for like to Joe and these lads, Joe Cannon, these lads, for players to get this decision right now as well for the next Galway manager, because they'll look to be competing again, and you're under pressure when you go into Galway there as well, because they have a team that should be up there about. So you're going to have to get to a semi-final or a final or win it, or unless the Galway public won't be happy with you as well.
Well, unless you say we're going to bring all these minors in and you buy yourself 3 or 4 years and win nothing for them. Like, I mean, that's why I respect Liam Sheedy. He didn't go down that road, and he could have with Tip. He went all in his first. We're going with that, and only in Ireland would be success.
He knew what he had. He knew the players, the nucleus of it. The 2010 team are still playing now, their last Sunday as well. So, he stuck with him. He knew what was in him too, to be fair. Like, you know, the kind of way. So he just kind of stuck him. And when a manager backs a player like that, they'll look at the player at all. They're going to kind of back him up to the last as well. And in fairness to the hurlers, didn't let him down all year, to be fair.
Yeah, they didn't. Did you see Tommy Walsh reading out the poem on off the ball? Now, I thought this was amazing stuff, in that I had only heard little bits and pieces of Tommy before, and I couldn't believe he was reading this off a script. And then I just started thinking, why is he not commentating on games? Like, not being a co-commentator, why is he not actually commentating? Imagine, like, the ability to read off a script and paint the kind of picture like that. That's a real skill, and that's natural for him. Like, I was thinking him describing the play would be unbelievable, wouldn't it? Like, why?
I tune in anyway, you know, that kind of way.
But I was thinking, and he'd throw in little funny bits, like, you know, like a rabbit chasing a fox, and you know, that Micheál O'Meara, was that Micheál O'Hare or Micheál O'Meara?
But
like, I mean, that would be in Tommy to be able to
be natural to him. The one-liners come out of him.
I think he's a natural commentator in the making.
Yeah, Tommy's probably the best kept secret there in the whole country there for a long time when he was hurling, but since he's hurling then, he's after coming out and he's blossoming. Look, he's just naturally funny, he's naturally gifted, and in regard, I've seen that now, and you're kind of, I'd say anyone didn't scroll past Twitter without clicking in and see what he's saying. But even with the passion with him, he was head to head down reading it, but the head was going and he was getting into it and getting into it and getting into it, and he'd bring a lot of passion to the table there as well, to be fair. And I'd say anyone would love to listen to him up and down the country.
Him and Milan might be a bit of a crazy mix, Paddy, but like, genuinely, I don't know, like, I can only tell you, when I'm reading off scripts here, it's not that easy to do. You need a lot of practice, and to read off a script as fast as he did, unless he'd learned it off, but you still have to deliver it the way he did, Paddy. And that's what commentators are good at, you know, and setting the scene. And geez, I would love to give him a couple of league games next year and as a commentator and see how he would pan out for it.
Yeah, I think I didn't know what you were talking about on Twitter first when you were on about, but then I looked at it again. But definitely, I think you have a point there. Like, he's a great analyst, and when you're involved in hurling that much in GAA, you don't listen to as much maybe as other sports, because I think you know it all yourself. But I think Tommy is a great lad to listen to, but his passion is absolutely unbelievable. I think a lot of commentators would be in trouble if he was the one starting to do it. And he's very, very humble, is the other thing. He never thinks he knows more than everybody else. He could be, I always laugh because he's one of the best hurlers ever. It's a top few. But like, he never, he always talks to other players like they're nearly better than he is, which they weren't. So that humility in him, I think, is very admirable. And geez, I'd love to see him commentating on a few anyway.
Yeah, no, definitely. It would be fantastic, wouldn't it?
Yeah, his younger brother done a bit for KCLR there a few years ago as well. Yeah, Shane, I think he was on, listening to him on one of the league matches.
Co-commentating or commentating?
Oh, co-commentating. The younger brother, like, I think he was younger now, back in, it could have been 15 or 16 back in the day, but no, he was very, very funny as well, very witty, like, you know what I mean. So he's very
unless he stays with News Talk, and if they tried to get rights themselves, he could do it with them. But I honestly think I think he could quit his job and go full time at that. I'm actually holding out somebody just giving this lad a chance here.
You're pushing him, Willie.
I'm really pushing Tommy Walsh as a commentator. I hope he's not a disaster if he ever does it. Right, come here, we'll take a break, lads, and we'll come back with some Player of the Year talk. So, Player of the Year, lads. So I was joking in the hotel the other morning with Shane McCallan, and he was joking with me that it's not my destiny to win that or whatever. And like, I mean, I think the Sunday game panel picking Noel McGrath as man of the match and as Player of the Year, I can see where they're coming from. For me, Callan is a shoe-in. I think it's very, very interesting. Brendan Maher was asked about it, and he says, this is about Callan. Now, you have to remember, his other teammate, Noel McGrath, is in the running for this. And this is what Brendan Maher said about Callan. He has to get it, but it's not our decision. The lads will put up three players and the players will vote. Obviously, we're going to give him the vote in our camp, our camp, and even Noel McGrath's camp. He says, but you don't know outside of that. It's out of your control. But I do think he deserves it. Like, I joked with Shamey, Jesus, you'll be livid if you don't get it this time. Yeah. And he was laughing about it. But what do you think, JJ? Like, I mean, there is a good shout for Noel McGrath too. I thought Callan was a shoe-in myself.
I only think it was probably a two-horse race now between himself and TJ, but I think with the final that Shamey put in, and I'd say the way Brendan is speaking about it, I'd say the leadership that Shamey brought to the whole thing has been captain this year as well, and I'd say they've probably seen a better side of him this year as well, that he brought on probably a lot more ownership, more leadership. But it goes in 8 games, and he speaks for himself. He should have got it 3 years, I think it was 2016, was it? He should have got that year only for a split vote with himself and Páraig Maher.
Yeah.
Hopefully that doesn't happen again.
But that will happen. Yeah, but him and Noel will be shortlisted, right?
Yeah, I thought I'd have Shamey ahead of Noel, I'll be honest with you, I would. I'd have probably Brendan Maher slightly ahead of Noel as well.
Really?
From what he done throughout the year, like, and coming back from a cruciate as well, a phenomenal year. I think Shamey now is his destiny on his name, his captain. Tipperary won the All-Ireland. He's scored 8 goals in 8 games. Now, he doesn't get a dish or he just may forget about that. Throw the hat at him.
Yeah, but the weird thing is, Paddy, like, it's the players that vote this. So, like, I mean, there can be no complaining about journalists or anything like that. Like, is Shamey liked in the hurling world? Like, I mean, whenever I meet him, I really like him.
Yeah, no, I don't know if he liked in the hurling world. I just know that anyone who's a Tipperary fan alive ever come across over the years loves him. Like, he actually has, he doesn't do an awful lot of media, I suppose, so you mightn't see it that often, but he is an absolutely fantastic personality. I've known him since he was in school. We were both in school and he was a little brat, all right, but and he's never lost that, but he's a great laugh. He's fantastic crack and all the rest, but I don't think people actually see that. They just see him on the field, and maybe when he was a younger player, that physically he mightn't have been up to it, so he was getting thrown around, and maybe on big days it wasn't happening for him. But I think over the last few years he's been a great leader for Tipperary. Like, people even have to think about the injuries he suffered. He's come into a couple of championships in the last 2 years. I think actually 16 and maybe last year with really bad injuries. Last year he was in a really, really bad way to getting a procedure before championship. So I would love to see him get it. I don't know if he's liked or not, but I'd love to see him get it. I think usually I'd say whoever's the best on the year, but he's after going through it a few years where he was, you know, our top marksman, and 16, I think, you know, it's a bit of a joke. But I would love to see him get it this year. And I think there'll be, you know what, I think there'll be a little campaign. I think there'll be a lot of talk from the Tip camp that they want him to get it. And I don't think, I think Noel McGrath's a sort of lad, shouldn't bother him one bit if he got it. He'd still have the same night of the All-Stars, he wouldn't care.
Yeah. But let's think, so our own Brian Carroll was tweeting about this. So I thought, Shamey, it was never done before to score a goal in every round, but obviously before it was just three rounds or four rounds. So it's been done. It's been done in 1956 by a man called Nicky Rackard. You might not have heard of him. He scored 12-15 in four games, scored in all four. So, like, I mean, that's
a hat-trick every game.
That's outrageous. Well, it depends how many he got.
He might have phenomenal scoring.
No disrespect. He could have played, I don't want to say my own card. He could have played Westmead and got
six against Antrim, I think.
Six against Antrim, was it? Yeah, that would make sense. Okay. And then Oliver McGrath in 1960, he got 4-3 in four games. Donny Nealon, he got four goals in three games. Sean McLaughlin in 1965 got 6-1 in three games. Tony Doran in 1968 got 6-3 in three games. 1974, Pat Delaney, 5-3 in four games. Eddie Kerr, 75, he got 4-23 in three games. Charlie McCarthy in 1976, 3-8 in three games. Noel Lane in 1987 got two goals in two games. He did well to make that list.
I literally got that myself.
TJ Reid, there was a big gap then. TJ Reid in 2015 got 4-32 in four games, a goal every game. And then you have Shamey Cannellan, 2019 gets 8-20 in eight games, so double any other game. So let's say, for me, that's never been done before, and that should be a new record based on the new kind of championship layout of eight games.
Taking consideration that he was took off the freeze at the start of the year as well, like, you know what I mean? To score that much and show that leadership was absolutely phenomenal. He could have very easily just throw the ties out of the prime and said, I'm on the freeze as well, but he didn't. And he led the whole team now from start to finish, to be fair. But geez, 8 goals in 8 games, a phenomenal score.
I think
and they're different goals as well. Like,
oh yeah,
if you go back through every single one of them, there was a couple of poacher goals, a couple of balls he got in the 40-yard line and ran straight through, and the one against Limerick there as well.
And then the half volley, which is individual skill.
It wasn't just one goal that he was getting all the time, or it was handed to him. He had to earn a lot of his goals as well. And see, his assists he made for the year too, and that was phenomenal too. Like,
yeah, no, definitely. I think it would be fairer on Shamey or any Tip nominee. I know the fashion is to go two with one county, one with another, but would you not go Shamey, TJ Reid and Patrick Horgan, which no one would really complain about, and then you're not splitting the Tip vote, Paddy?
No, well, it would be fair, but then it's fair in one sense, but it's probably not fair to Noel. I would have said maybe would you have four or five players a year. Well, that's split up properly and you get your proper vote then, because you have Noel, you have Brendan, you have Shamey, you have TJ Reid, you have Pat Hogan, probably one or two more from in there. What's wrong with having a few more? Then you probably would maybe get a more definitive, might spread out the vote a little, and probably the cream then would probably come to the top.
Yeah, maybe it is. But listen, we'll keep our eye out for this, because we're in the Shamey Cannellan camp here on the GAR anyways. I think he deserves it at this stage. Finish up, lads, because this is our last hurling show of the year. We just want to take a look back on the year. What do you think, JJ? Was it a good championship? I know the All-Ireland final won't be remembered. No. The semi-finals will.
Yeah.
The Leinster Championship probably will. Munster Championship won't. Yeah. Joe McDonagh Cup will. Is that
summed up in a nutshell right there? Yeah, well, it could be ups and downs in it, really, more than anything, I suppose. Leinster Championship was phenomenal this year. You go back to the game in Wexford Park, one puck of the ball could have dictated four different teams' outcome. You know, that was probably that probably never will happen again.
Yeah,
that was very, very good, you know. And two games were playing at the same time there as well. And a lot of lads in Wexford Park didn't know whether they were true now or not, or in the Galway lads couldn't believe when they were gone, you know, didn't enter their head they were going to be gone at that.
Yeah.
Then you have Leash's breakthrough, the win against Dublin there as well in the in the first round or the knockout of championship there as well. So yeah, there have been ups and downs with a couple of bad games thrown in there as well, few one-sided games, all right. But yeah, overall, you're probably saying, was it as good as last year? You're probably realistically it's not, but it had its moments, so to be fair, in the championship, you know, and the Leinster championship, and then the two semi-finals were phenomenal for different reasons there as well.
Yeah, what do you think? What do you think, Paddy?
Yeah, I just think them semi-finals are just brilliant, like the ultimate competitive matches, and oftentimes they have one great semi-final and one damn squid, and it was absolutely brilliant. I think the final, if we had had a final, maybe 2:15 aside for the whole match, it would have got that bit more crazy in the second half, because there was a bit shadow boxing at times in the first half. I think if we had that semi-final really, really good, I think we would have forgot about the rest of it. But, you know, I thought Cork and Kilkenny, I really enjoyed that match, how Kilkenny kind of brought back that spirit of old. Leinster Championship, really, really good. But you're always, like, this could happen every year, that one of the divisions, one of the provinces is going to be end up with dead rubbers and stuff like that. So it is to be expected. So as long as the year finishes fairly good, I'd say the GAA will be happy. But they might have to have a look at it in another couple of years. But look, it was a little disappointing at times. So those two semi-finals for me are absolutely unbelievable. But pity maybe that if Richie Hogan gets sent off in the final, we would have maybe finished on a real high.
Finished on a real high. That was the, well, you did finish on a real high, Paddy, I suppose, looking at it.
I'll be happy either way. Diplomatic. I don't really care.
Yeah. But that's the thing, I suppose, the two semi-finals, and I think what made the two semi-finals that it pitted Leinster against Munster. Do you know what I mean? I think that adds to it. I don't like when it's two from the same counties in Aller in semi-finals.
Yeah, they're dominating. And probably
two from the same provinces,
yeah,
right?
And probably two teams, probably two different games, really, more than that, whereas Davy and Wexford brought a tactical approach to it, whereas Kilkenny and Limerick were just kind of go toe-to-toe, and Tipperary's character was probably not questioned, but it was kind of before the game, but the last 20 minutes they put that to bed now as well, like, you know what I mean? So it's
now I have to pull you up on Limerick and Kilkenny going toe to toe, as you say, like, yeah. I mean, that was very tactical too. There was half back lines staying in positions and stuff as well.
It was tactical, but it wouldn't be as open as the Wexford and Tipperary game, because you see the Wexford Tipperary game first 10 minutes, Wexford was running through, I think Sean Murphy went through, and it was 2-on-1 situation. There wasn't anyone in 40 yards of it. That's because Wexford retreated and then they broke from the half-back line as well. That kind of thing. Whereas you wouldn't have that only space in Kilkenny and Limerick game, because it was compacted really more.
I saw, just to pull you up on that as well, in the first half against Tipperary, because you can only see it when you're at the match, but Colin Fenley was left alone on his own inside. And there might not have been anybody inside, at least definitely not the 45, but Kilkenny were bringing both Mullen and Richie Hogan out and swarming that middle third. It's not that dissimilar to Wexford.
Mullen's been doing that all year, to be fair. He has been
doing
that,
but Richie was out as well.
Wexford does it more obvious. They don't make excuse for it. They go with the sweeper, and then they have to go in that middle third. When they get the ball in, they kind of run through the defence rather than hit the ball in.
They run the ball more.
They go long with the puck out, but after that then they're kind of run through the lines and pop off a pass and a player on the shoulder. So when they do break that half-back line, there's only one-on-one in there, like, you know. And they're very unlucky against Tip. They could have two more goals in the first 10 minutes as well. Like, you know, the O'Keefe had a chance as well and kind of spilt it a small bit too, you know.
My point to you is that Kilkenny, I think, are evolving more towards a Wexford style than maybe an old traditional style. Would that be fair? Maybe not the running it through the hands, but
they're going towards the Limerick style really more than anything, and Tipperary style to a certain extent there as well, like, you know. Whereas they're kind of half forwards. Our half forwards were always going up the field when I was playing.
But you're adding in two corner forwards potentially into that break and area.
It was always two. Now, I suppose Colin used to be his role evolved in the team. He used to be a worker out in the wing, but now he's actually the main man in the full forward line, whereas he's told to stick right into the goal itself, because he's the probably main goal threat now at the moment, you know, kind of way. So they're evolving, all right, but they're adapting to the players they have as well. Sure, if you were any manager, you have to adapt to every player, any players have it in front of them, they have to adapt to that as well.
Yeah. Did you see any differences there, Paddy, when you were watching a match with Kilkenny? Now, I haven't been to too many games this year, but I definitely saw them swarming that middle area a lot, and Colin Fenley just being isolated, which I've no problem with that tactic, but I do think there's
I think they always did it, though. I do think they always did it. They always tried to hold their half back line and midfield in position. And I think it was the capacity of their forward line to work so hard. I think it's underrated how fit and strong and long their forwards were, that they had arms and legs everywhere. And I think it's struggling a little bit to hold that for a full match. But I saw Finley was in there on his own a lot. I thought it was a good tactic, because they were able to hold people out a little bit out the field, and you thought maybe that Fenley might give Ron O'Mahar a bit of trouble if they got it. But I think his runs weren't fantastic. They were straight out the field, and the balls in were straight down on top of him. So it really gave Ron O'Mahar a physical battle, whereas they probably would have preferred to hit the ball either side, so you'd have to make him run with Colin Finlay and give Colin a better chance to get on the ball. So I think that's why it didn't look like it was working. And look, by the time the second half came, I think we had a lot of bodies back, and they felt they had to go along, which wasn't that wise. I thought the biggest difference I've seen with Kilkenny is when they're getting it coming out of backline. It used to be just get the ball and drive it as far as you can. They do that a little bit, but now I see a few 1-2s. I definitely see men running off the shoulder and trying to take hand pass, and they were giving Tip a lot of trouble in the first 15-20 minutes with that, so I was surprised they didn't try and push that to the limit in the second half.
Yeah, and they played some good diagonal balls as well, JJ. The one thing I don't like to come out of this year, and Tommy Dunn has been talking about it, and this is VAR and video help. Right. Can't have this, JJ, can we? Like, I mean, and I'm not a hurling man, and I would dread it in Gaelic football, yeah. Or look at a mess it is in soccer, because a lot of it, look at Richie Hogan. Like, I mean, there's a debate even with slowed down replays of whether this, you're slowing a game down. Yeah. You're like, I mean, the hurling surely doesn't need this. It's not gone that bad.
Talking about that and the two referees, I wouldn't agree with that either, I'll be honest with you. What I do, a small little tweak, is take the timing away from the referee and take the score taken away from the referee. Two small things that they can do straight away to help the referee actually referee the game. Referees don't train to take down scores or take the time. Let someone else in the stand do that. That's an easy job for someone else to do. So rather than you sitting at the 21, taking down a score, holding on you till the keeper to wait, and then have to run up the field, and then the ball is going to travel a lot quicker than anyone else. And when you're running up, how are you supposed to see the bat as it's going down, where the ball is actually landing? How is the back fouling? Is the forward fouling? How is he supposed to see it? And he's sprinting up the field like that after taking down and pressing his watch and taking down a score. Take that out of his hands. He doesn't have to do that. Someone else can do that. It's very, very plain to anyone to see that a referee, a fourth official, give him something to do there. Do that in the line.
He's listening to Cody and Sheedy and these lads.
Yeah, he's sitting down in the stand instead of actually listening to getting an earache. But there's a small tweak, because it's a massive jump going to two referees. The two referees could be refereeing completely differently there as well. So, or else what I heard there as well, give the linesman a bit more authority there as well, which is a valid point too. He can call frees and buzz over the referee, say, look, there's a free down here, you missed it. And
mic them up, the off the ball stuff. Yeah, definitely. Mic them up. What do you think, Paddy? Like, I mean, Jesus, I don't know. I'm not going to keep going on about it, but the VAR, I suppose, anyways.
I wouldn't go if they're near the VAR. I don't think there's that huge amount of incident. Like you put it the other day, I said, Jamie Callanan fouled in the box and all this. Usually they do even out a little bit. I know the semi-final Wexford seem to get a good few more, but I'd be like you. I don't think it'll be the overall betterment of the game. I think black and white things like scoring, brilliant. I definitely think linesmen and umpires need to have a greater influence. I've been talking about it for a long time about umpires, that they should be maybe younger referees that are coming up in the game. I mean, I don't think I need my brother-in-law or whoever the hell it's going to be an umpire in All-Ireland final day. I need a lad who's trained up the exact same as me, has experience of reffing matches, because I think they're too vital to decisions. And if you're going to the trouble of being a referee and doing it so often, being in the middle of the field, you're used to the pressure of it. You know exactly what should be considered fouls and not fouls. And I think, like, if you think about hurling even, just hurling on its own, there can be a scrum for the ball on 121 and the ref is right there on it, but it's gone up in 2 seconds, it's gone up to the other 21 and he can't be there. So when that high ball is coming in, like even the speed, if you're connected by the microphone, if the umpires are connected, they can say, well, there's been a pull on the jersey and the free can be given in. So I think they need a lot more help, and I fully agree with the taking the score and timing away from them as well. It's just complicating more things to have to think about in the head.
Yeah, no, you're right. There's enough eyes on it. Yeah. It's just if you use them properly. Come here, JJ, before we finish up, I meant to ask you about this. Did you notice Cody in on the pitch towards the end of the game, standing a few yards in on it? Like, why was he doing this? Because he was just thick, was he?
I'd say you want to go in and hurl a couple of ball there. I'd say go in Conor Farr, get a goal or something like that, but no.
Has he done this before? Or no?
I'd say he has, yes. He wouldn't say that's his first time doing it, I'd say.
The Kilkenny County Board will be fined for that, obviously.
I'd say so. It wouldn't be the first time to be fined for it either. No. And the linesman wasn't saying that to him either.
No, but we were joking about this on Monday. Like, who would be brave enough to get back in there?
No, I wouldn't say it's his first time on the field either. Like, you know, I'd say he just probably knew the game was gone away now at that particular stage near the end, and he's just kind of trying to get his G up in the players, but obviously it wasn't going to work.
But this was with 2 or 3 minutes to go. Mm. He wasn't G-ing anyone up. He was just in on the field, standing, watching it. It was a bizarre sight. I don't know if you noticed it.
No, I said I seen him on it all right now, and I seen himself and Sheedy having a couple of words there at the end of the game as well. Or Sheedy was screaming for a free that Tib got, and Cody took exception to it. But look, the met each other after it. All right, now they shook hands and
a very brief shake.
Yeah,
hands.
Very brief. All right, but you're lucky again. Your emotions are high at that stage. I'd say you're not looking away, so they probably will meet each other eventually over the winter, and they'll chat away about it as well.
Yeah, is there no love lost between the two of them, Paddy, or is it this just a completely competitive environment where you know they just turn into competitors, and you know that's what that was about.
I'd say that's what that's about. I'd say there's just, I suppose Brian has never come up against a lad who has been able to frame over a consistent amount of time, and I suppose they've played each other, what is it, 3 times now, 2-1 to Liam and all that crack, and I suppose Brian isn't used to somebody getting the better over him, and Liam is like, you know, I don't know Brian well, but I know Liam fairly well, definitely in a dressing room capacity, and he's just such a competitor. He's like a bulldog, you know, tied up on the sideline, and he's just so passionate that he probably would get on your nerves if you're on the other team, because he seems to have everything under control. So I'd say it's just the two of them are used to winning, and when the other isn't in, they're not used to it.
Yeah. And as Brian Carroll says, Sheedy gets down in some sort of a sumo squat to watch the match at some stages. You see him at that.
He just explodes then, doesn't he?
He's like a jack-in-the-box on the sideline. Just to finish up, lads, we're back into club season when the football finishes. And Aaron Gillan got his jaw broken last night, or I think it was last night, against, last Friday's group game against Kilmallock. And Keane Lynch got sent off. Did you see his sending off?
No.
Oh, Jesus. It was against Gavin O'Mahony, who used to hurl with Limerick. Yeah. So it was a throw-in ball, and they both pulled. Did you see it, Paddy? And Keane just lashed across.
I heard it went off.
Jesus. It was unreal. But that's the funny thing is, just no matter who you are, you go back to club hurling.
Oh, I'll bring you back down there fairly quick.
Some club hurler's going to hop off you, and that's the way it is, right?
You have to expect it when you go back to the club, and lads going to absolutely hop off you as well. And even your lads in club training would do that for you as well. Like, you know what I mean? You're welcome back. After
the only club lads, you're no prima donna when you go back.
No, all equal.
You've been playing away kind of, JJ. What's the story in Tip, Paddy? Have you got any notification of when you're going to be playing Championship, or what way is it going to work?
Yeah, no. I thought they were pretty good about it this year, being honest, because we had the under-20s involved for a lot of the year too, and they're in the final now. So they were giving us kind of, if we get beaten against Wexford, if they win against Wexford, that's the day to be. So look, I've often been critical over not letting us know when we'll be playing if certain results happen for the county, but they had this year, so we're out Saturday week. And as I say now, the boys will have to come back in training now after a couple of days of enjoyment. And as JJ said, there'll be loads of lads looking to get one over on them.
So you can look forward to that. Well, listen, lads, that's all we've time for. So the last show of the year, we got the two lads that shared the analysis seats in the very GAR started working. So that's it. We'll be back with the hurling show for the league next year. Other than that, we'll be combining it with the football show. So all the hurling snobs are going to have to listen to some of the big ball talk. You have no choice.
You
can skip forward. And I am accused of being a bit too biased towards football when we combine them, because Conan knows nothing about hurling and I've nobody to talk. When I'm the expert on hurling, there's a big problem. All right, that's all we've time for. We'll be back next year for the league. But if you want to listen to the combined show, we'll continue right throughout the league. We'll talk to you then. Good luck.